Well, welcome all. My name is Katrín Oddsdóttir and I will be your moderator or fundarstjóri today. We will try to do this in English, whereas our guests are at least two of them English speaking. And we're very lucky to have them here today. I see that there's more interest than was expected, so I'm sorry for those of you who can't make it into the room. I think you should try to squash behind there if you want. There's always a possibility of sitting tight. All of us probably know the first speaker today. It's this Eva Jolie, who sort of came, sorry, second speaker, yes, excuse me. I will start by mentioning our first speaker, which is Jóhannes Kári Kristjánsson, with Reykjavík Media, who's a journalist and did a very important thing, as we all know, in the Panama Papers, revealing conflicted interest, which had, of course, huge effect here in Iceland. I think what we will do is we will give about 20 minutes to each of the talk. After that, we will get our moderators, which I will introduce then, and we will get them to comment, and then I really want to focus on having possibility for interaction. So we should try to keep it very tight, and everybody should try to speak not endlessly, but rather sort of to the point, so that we can actually have a conversation, which is always more helpful than monologues, in my opinion. So I will just start by asking Jóhannes to come and tell us what he has to say at this moment, and without further delay, actually. Thank you.
Hello. Hello, and I'm pleased to be here and have the chance to speak with about a story I worked on for so long, and to be here with Eva Jolie, who has been fighting tax evasion and tax havens for many years, and yeah. So, but I want to start to talk about the reality journalists face when they are trying to find the real owners of an offshore company. Maybe you will get a tip about a company, and you, of course, start by Googling it. And then, if you are lucky, then you will find some, you will have some result. And then you will find, if you are lucky, some directors of the company. And if you look further, then the directors are directors in thousands of other companies. And if you are extremely lucky, then you maybe can get the name of the person who has the power of attorney for the company. And that can be another offshore company. And in reality, it is almost impossible for a journalist to find the real owners of an offshore company. It's really hard. And there is an organization in Sarajevo called OCCRP, Organized Crime and Reporting, Organized Crime and Corruption Reporting Project. And they have specialized in finding the owners of offshore companies, and they have done a really good job, and they have helped me in my past research, and but they have to do it manually. They have to go to the place and try to get some information, so it is really hard to get the information about the beneficial owners of offshore companies. So in June last year, I was invited to Washington DC to the ICIJ headquarters, and we were about 15 journalists on this first meeting. The director of ICIJ, Gerard Ryle, he introduced the Panama Papers and the leak, and none of us understood what we were looking at that time, not until the technical officer of ICIJ started to introduce the database, and how we could search for names and companies and everything. And when I started to search in the database for Iceland and Reykjavik and Kópavogur and all the usual suspects, the names, the banksters and the business people, I was of course amazed, and everyone around me were amazed, because Iceland, as we all know now, is really big in the Panama Papers. And the Panama Papers give us a rare insight into the secret offshore world, where everything is about hiding money, avoid paying taxes, hiding assets, and to have a company to hide money from the drug market or from criminal organizations. So when I started to search the database, it was not an easy task, because I could search for a name and I got maybe 200 search results, and I had to check everything. And for example, you got a PDF file, and you had to go through maybe 100, 200 pages of PDF pages, and sometimes you didn't find the name. It was an error in the database. And I have heard some criticism about my work for 9 months searching and working on all the stories. Why did it take such a long time to do only this? But I was not working alone. I was working with a group of journalists all around the world, and because Iceland was so big, then I was helping a lot of journalists all around, because a cooperation is like this is called cross-border journalism, and you don't say no if someone asks for help. So for me and for all the journalists, the Panama Papers revealed how companies and law offices built up their secrecy. And you all know that by the seeing the stories or reading the stories from the Panama Papers. I don't have to go through that. I also want to use the opportunity to talk about the interview with the Prime Minister, because myself and my colleagues, we have been criticized heavily for that interview, but we didn't decide to do it like this just a few days before the interview. Gerard Ryle, the director of ICJ, came to Iceland in December last year, and there we discussed how we should do it, and knowing that Iceland is a small country and everybody knows everything, if I, as a journalist, pretty well known in Iceland, would take up the phone and call and ask for a company called Wintris, then the word would spread out fast. So that I couldn't do that until the sport just right before the story broke. So, and we the foreign journalists we that were working on this interview with me, they said, okay, if you invite the Prime Minister for an interview about Wintris, then all his assistants, they will get the chance to manipulate the story before you interview him. So that was a crucial thing, of course. And nothing if you searched for Wintris on the internet, you had to search with, you have to go, you know, deep in Google to find something about Wintris, and the only thing you could find was that Wintris was a creditor in the banks. So we decided to do it like this, to take the interview like this from pure journalism. We discussed the ethical part of it, and we all agreed that this was ethical. This was such a big story. We were talking about the Prime Minister of Iceland, and as my foreign journalist colleagues said, well, he is the Prime Minister. He should be able to answer all questions, even regarding an offshore company he owns. So, and the most important thing for me is that the story is right. Nothing has been, I mean, the story is right. And the other part is that we offered the former Prime Minister several times to another interview, so that was another important ethical part in regarding all this. But the headline of this event is The World After the Panama Papers. Few days ago, Transparency International posted a story on its website, and the headline was, British Virgin Islands, have they cleaned up since the Panama Papers? According to the story, only 16,000 new companies registered in the first half of 2016, a drop by 30% compared to the same period last year. 16,000 companies were registered in the British Virgin Islands the first 6 months of this year. So that is a lot of companies. And there has been some penalties by the BVI authorities. The highest penalty was $31,500 applied to Mossack Fonseca BVI branch. The providers of offshore companies, mostly internet companies where you can go online and register a company, must laugh at the amount, because a basic incorporation package in the BVI starts at $1,375 and can cost up to $5,325 for BVI Premium, international business company owned by a Belize trust. With those kinds of fees, the average offshore provider in BVI can recover from a $31,500 administrative fine within a few days. So we are not talking about a lot of money here. So in reality, what has changed? I remember when I was working on the story in March with my colleague Adalsteinn and my colleagues from the national television, we actually talked about and asked ourselves, will this change something? We didn't have the answer then, but we know what changed here in Iceland, and we don't have to discuss about that. But has something changed in the world when we are looking at the offshore world? Yes, some governments has been changing the laws and regulations. Tax authorities are investigating some companies and using the Panama Papers to do that. But I think the most important thing is for the public, because the public now knows how this world works. And the power of the public is, of course, important. But I know also that next time, the guy with the money he will think, okay, maybe my all information about my company will be leaked to ICIJ or some other news organization, so I have to be more careful now. Because we are not talking about that Mossack Fonseca is the only law firm that are doing this, even though Mossack Fonseca is big in Panama. But there are thousands of law offices and accounting offices that are doing the same. So, and I have been one of the Icelandic banks, Landsbankinn, was really big in the Panama Papers with at least 404 companies formed by Mossack Fonseca for Landsbankinn. But what about Kaupthing and what about Glitnir at that time? What office did they use to form some offshore companies? I would really like to have that leak. But at the end, I just want to talk about Reykjavik Media, the company I founded after the Panama Papers. I am not myself, but me and my colleagues, we are working on more stories from the Panama Papers and some other stories, of course. And I've been abroad a lot, being asked to talk on conferences regarding the Panama Papers, and that has been great for me, because in every trip I get a tip about the story linked to Iceland, because the world is a small place at the end. But as always, when I talk on conferences, I ask you to contact me if you have any stories, and maybe and hopefully we can publish something important. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Johannes. And is there any chance that those there at the back could try to sneak behind there so that they could possibly see better or hear a bit better?
Because it's
yes, it's true. But maybe the interest wasn't known beforehand, but this is great that so many people want to participate. Next, we will have a person that we know well here in Iceland, who is Eva Sjoli. I have a small private story to tell about this, because when the crash happened in Iceland, I was at a wedding and I sat next to a guy that I had never met before. And I asked him, so what are your hobbies in life and what are you doing or something like that? He said, well, I'm an architect, but currently I'm working for Eva Sjoli. And that was Jón Þórisson, who is here today also. And at the time, I felt like so many others, like, can I help? Eva Sjoli had recently came to the country and there was so much happening and there was a ray of hope coming with her. So I asked him, I'm just a law student, but can I somehow help? Is there anything I can do? Can I go through some documents? So I formed a little group with people who were law students at the time, and we got to meet Eva Sjoli for 1 hour, and she talked about philosophy and told us to try to look at the broad picture. And it was a wonderful talk. I don't think we did any good or any help, but it was very, very rewarding for us. So I want to thank you for that. Currently, Eva is working, of course, in the European Parliament. She's a member of the Green Party. And now she is the vice president of the Panama Paper Committee, which the European Parliament has, called PANA. They have started their work recently, and now they're meeting every week and trying to get this going, trying to look at all this great information that has been revealed and putting together some sort of a plan of action, I hope. She also works as a full member of LIPE, which is a committee of home affairs within the parliament, and mostly concentrates on the refugees issue. So she's doing a lot of good things there. But also, for 18 months now, she has been working as a lawyer again. So she is the youngest, oldest lawyer in France, as she says herself. I really would like to welcome her. Thank you, Eva.
Good afternoon, everybody.
It's very nice for me to be back here in Reykjavik at this important moment of your history. I want to start with a little story about refugees. Do you know that Italy used to run a ship for rescue that was called Mare Nostra, that has rescued more than 150,000 refugees close to the coast of Libya? It cost $15 million a year, and Italy asked Europe for help to share the cost of this boat. Europe said, no, we can't afford it. And this boat was then withdrawn, and they used small coast guards that was not appropriate after that. And as you know, 3,000 refugees drowned, and we could have saved at last half of them. This was a question of $15 million. Do you know how much Bankia, the Spanish bank, gathering of seven saving banks, how much money they got from Europe? $24 billion. After they got the $24 billion, they ruined 300,000 people by selling products they call preferencia. People thought that they would have interest on it their whole life, and they discovered that this interest was linked to the benefit of the bank, and there was no benefit. This bank decided on purpose to ruin 300,000 people because they needed to reinforce their capital, and they needed capital, and this was a way of doing it. Did the banking authority make an inquiry into what happened with Bankia? No. Did the prosecutors start an investigation to see whether this was normal? No. Who started the investigation? Citizens. It was Simona Levi who started it. She's a tango dancer. And she said, this is not possible. They are crooks. It's not a natural catastrophe. And she set up a secured platform asking all by the social networks to send documentation of what they could have about Rodrigo Rato, who was intended to become Spain's next prime minister and is the former head of the Monetary Fund. And within a few months, she got the proofs that more than 60 persons in the Spanish society had black cards, had credit cards that did debit directly a special account in the bank. And they used it nearly without limits. They are not now, and Simona went to a special prosecutor, not corrupt one, and the inquiry started. You see what corruption is doing. It is destroying the institutions. You cannot trust the institutions to do their work. And there are other terrific examples. The last one is about Royal Bank of Scotland. Royal Bank of Scotland has cost English taxpayers £45 billion. And we now know that they have ruined 16,000 small and medium companies for the same purpose, to increase their assets, because they need to comply with the Basel rules of the equilibrium. They decided it. There are mails telling this that are now public. Nobody did look into Royal Bank of Scotland after they got the 45 billions. Nobody has been held accountable. And people who had their bonuses have kept them. And ordinary citizens are ruined, their life is destroyed, and these banksters get away with it. It is impunity. And this is why we have to understand that corruption is really destroying democracy. When you have crony, when you have conflict of interest, when you are sitting on both sides of the table, when people are too close to each other, democracy is lost. And I do think that when a country, a small country like Iceland, with its highly educated citizens and its aspiration for a lively democracy, when you learn that more than 600 members of your community has set up offshore companies, and that among them it is the Prime Minister, the Minister of Finance, and the Minister of Interior, this is not to live with. And I will tell Johannes that there is not an ethical problem about asking the Prime Minister, where does this society come from? It's a totally legitimate question. And the pity is that you haven't got the answer. Not really. And why should we believe these people when they say, this is legal, just pass your way. It's not forbidden to set up a company. But then think twice. Why should you set up an offshore company if you have nothing to hide? Why should you pay for advisors and attorneys to do it? We have empiry on this. If you go to the US Senator Levin, he did conduct the inquiry committee in the American Senate into private banking, and he asked these bankers, among your clients, those who set up offshore companies, how many do you think have a legitimate purpose? The answer, and this you can find easily, I will give it to Jon, so you can send it around. They answered, well, about 99.5% is illegitimate. This is what we know. And saying that it is legitimate to not pay taxes, to, like the multinationals say, they have been saying for decades, it's legal. But now people say we don't believe it. We believe that you are misusing these constructions in tax havens in order not to pay taxes. As to these offshore companies belonging to individuals, it is not only about taxes. It is not only not to pay taxes. It is also to hide things that you cannot talk about. Corruption money. It is to hide the kickback you did receive on privatizations, for instance. So it's terribly important not to believe people that don't want to show, because they had the possibility to answer the journalist, to give the documents from the bank account of this offshore company, saying, here you see the amount, this is the inheritance of my wife, and this is what I did with it. But that this document was never shown. So I think, and so what my message is that corruption is really destroying society. It has terrible effect, excuse me. And it is even destroying peace building. I have been working in Afghanistan, in Kabul, for 3 years, trying to help civil society to get over the war. We have all paid to Afghanistan more than $100 billion for that. And I'm sorry to say that most of this money has gone into offshore companies and into flats in Dubai, houses in Dubai, and never served the Afghan people. So when you see that the inquiries are not being conducted, and this is true also in France, we have a lot of examples. When you see in France that the former president, Sarkozy, is still running for a new term while he has many indictments or many inquiries ongoing, and one that is very serious is he has spent twice the amount that was allowed for his electoral campaign, 20 million more than was foreseen, and there is very heavy suspicions that he received $50 million from Gaddafi. This is an ongoing inquiry. but this doesn't stop him from running, and he hates investigators, investigative journalists, and churches. So what is important for the Icelandic people today, I think, is to change, is to understand that your society has been eaten up from inside by people who has taken a lot of advantages for themselves and their friends, and that it's time to change. And you have the possibility to give them a political sanction. You can stop voting for them. That is your right. And you can say, as Podemos did in Spain, that you, the people, or the five stars in Italy, you want to take the power back. You want to invest in the higher position in your society, citizens that you trust and that are not linked to any network, that don't run aluminium plants or other, that don't have any links to groups. So I will not hide it anymore. I'm hoping that Birgitta Jonsdottir will be your next prime minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. Thank you. I can see the journalists going like, this is the scoop. Thank you so much, Eva. Now we're going to have a small break, I think, but there's a lot of us in this room. So I'm going to be very strict. I'm going to say it's now 16:34, according to my watch. At 16:44, everybody has to be back inside. And you can try to rearrange a little bit so everybody can get back inside. But this is a strictly 10-minute break. Is that 15-minute break? Okay. 49. Thank you. Okay, we will continue. So there are some more seats now. At least I can see two or three here at the front that are free. And also there's the meeting is being live streamed in the next room. So if you want to sit, you could go there. Of course, it's more fun here. Also, this meeting is being live streamed, like I said, on the website of the Nordic House. So if you would like to point it out to your friends on social media or whatever, they could participate if they weren't able to make it. Now, we will next go through the panel states, which is always a fun stage, of course. What I would like to ask, if I may, is that we would try to focus on solutions, because we do know that there's a lot of problems. And I really am very glad that we're talking about those problems. But you could get highly depressed if you don't talk about the solutions at the same time as the problems. So I think we should try to do both. So I would be very glad if people could raise whatever they say as would be the biggest problem or their biggest worry, but would also match it with something that could be a solution, because I think then we'll have a more constructive meeting. So I will, of course, misuse the opportunity and talk about the new Icelandic constitution, which I think is a huge ray of hope for us here in this island, but I won't take it any further than this. I would like to introduce the panel next. Standing here on my right is Þórður Snær Júlíusson, who is the editor of Kjarnin, which is a web medium that us Icelanders know well. Next to him is Sigurbjörg Sigurgeirsdóttir, who is a docent of public administration at the University of Iceland. Then we have Birgitta Jónsdóttir, who is one of the pirates running for this parliamentary elections, and who has a lot of knowledge about leaks also, that I know. And then we have Lawrence Lessig, who is a law professor at Harvard University, who has been so kind as to move to Iceland for a few months, and I think that is doing us a great good to be able to listen to Lawrence, because he has this sort of guest's auga, you know, the eye of the guest, which is always very helpful for us here at this place in the middle of the Atlantic. So what I would like to do is just start with you, Þórður, and just go one by one, and I will give you about 2 or 3 minutes to just talk about what you think, about what you heard. If you want to raise any questions, please wait until everybody has finished, and then we can have some fun, and then you can direct questions at people, both them and, of course, Eva and Johannes. So we'll get like a huge talk going. So please, Þórður, the floor is yours.
Well, First of all, because I worked on part of the Panama Papers with Johannes and his company and some of the international media that worked on the leaks. I want to start off saying that a lot of the things that I saw there did not surprise me at all. There was a suspicion that we had had for many years after the collapse of the banks. All the information that we found inside the banks that had been revealed implied that there were a lot of offshore companies hidden in tax havens that had been founded by all three banks. And what the Panama Papers did, or Panama Leak did, was reveal a lot of the, I mean, a lot of the sort of the so-called banksters, how they hid large, you could call them treasures, in such offshore havens, the implications that some of the politicians had, and it sort of was the missing puzzle of the piece. But the implications and so what happened here afterwards, the toppling of a government almost, the change of the prime minister, the biggest protest in the history of Iceland, hasn't done us a lot of social good. It has, it didn't help us heal the wound of mistrust that has been, has opened up between the public and most of the institutions of Icelandic society in these last few years. It has widened the wound more, and I think because we're talking about solutions, we need to find a way to heal that wound and build up the trust between the institutions and the public, and we won't do that until the spotlight is put firmly on the scope of this problem, the problem of two set of people living in the same country, one of them living in a separate economic reality, hiding money in offshore islands, and the other one living in Iceland, getting salary in Icelandic kronas and living with the consequences.
Thank you. Sigurbjörg.
Yes. Well, you were asking for good news and you were asking for solutions. Well, solutions, we first of all we have to start to understand the problem. And in academia we call corruption, we label it as a wicked problem. Why? This because corruption has got that nature, it's not easy to investigate. And it sort of behaves like the water. It always finds its way. The solutions, well, I would like to point out that the good news, that we are a country, we are a society in transition. We are changing. And what are the signs we have about that? Let me mention this. In a matter of one electoral term, we have had two resignations of ministers. I would think that's unique in Icelandic history. Why did that happen? Yes, it happened because we had a media which was strong enough and had stamina enough to publish information and follow them up. They didn't give up. So the outcome was a type of political accountability that takes the form of resignation. You notice I said type of political accountability because we have different levels of accountability. It doesn't always have to mean resignation, and that is something that our politicians just has to start to understand, that it is not always the question of resignation. There could be case for apologies and everything there in between, like stepping aside for a while, saying, okay, I understand that we've gotten into problems and I want this to be investigated and I'm not going to be in the scene while it's investigated. So this is the reality in Iceland, and that is an indication that we are changing. My worry would have been if there would have not been any political resignations under these circumstances that we were creating the soil for a political culture which our new generations would be marked by. Because we create political culture, we create the standards of political culture as we go. We cannot just keep saying, oh, this is the political norms in Iceland. Come on, we create the norms. And if there would not have been a resignation at that point, I would have particularly been much more worried about the future of Icelandic society and our young generations in politics.
Great, thank you so much. And Birgitta?
First of all, thanks everyone for being here, and thank you in particular, Madam Evasjuli. I think it is important to bear in mind that if we would not have had Madam Evasjuli come to Iceland to help us with the preparations in dealing with all this spaghetti, that those that know how to use the loopholes that they often actually themselves create when laws are being made, we would not have had our special prosecutor having such a strong mandate and built on such strong foundation. And that just shows, and you know, of course we have a lot of people in prison, and that sets also a new standard. So you know that if you are doing something crooked, there might actually be some consequences. And I think that is also important if we looked at the private sector. But it is also very important to bear in mind that, yeah, we are great, but there's just not enough of us. And so we need to seek advice from abroad when we are dealing with this deep nepotism that has led to a lot of corruption in Iceland. There is another thing I want to mention which is good, and that is before the crisis, there were no whistleblowing act. The laws around media and freedom of information were very weak, and because of a foresight that me and many other people from around the world had back in 2009 and 2010 when we created the Icelandic Modern Media Initiative, where we looked at all the best laws from around the world in order to create the initiatives for people to blow the whistle, and the accessibility for the media to be able to have access to information, but also to strengthen the possibilities for media to report. This is very important. And so, yes, we still live where there is like the idea of trickle-down economics ideas, where we really should be having trickle-down ethics, where the people that are leaders in our society in all the different fields would set good examples. And so I think people are starting to recognize that this is needed. We are really, like Sigurdur said, in these transitional times. And I really have high hopes in the people of Iceland that they really want to find ways to deal with this deep-rooted corruption that has infested in our society.
Thank you. Lawrence.
So I've been so grateful to have the chance to be here because there are so many reasons to envy this place and this culture. And one is the type of corruption you have. You see, because there's an important distinction between illegal corruption and legal corruption. And what you've just seen is an extraordinary effort to unpack and to reveal the illegal corruption that is within the society. And that is a beautiful kind of corruption, because when that corruption is revealed, either through the work of prosecutors like Eva Joly or through journalists who do their extraordinary work revealing the truth, the public rallies to the idea that we should do something about this corruption. You march on parliament and governments resign and people celebrate the idea that there is hope for democratic process to work. But I come from a country where I'm sure there's tons of illegal corruption. But the problem in America is not the illegal corruption. The problem in America is the legal corruption. It's a system of government where members of Congress spend 30 to 70% of their time raising money to get back to Congress and raising it from the tiniest fraction of the 1%. And what that obviously does is produce a government that can't help but answer the wishes of that tiny fraction of the 1%. And when the journalists write about this, there's no scandal. This is in plain sight. Everybody sees and knows this is the system. And so when the journalists tell us this story, we turn the channel to another reality TV show or star or something insane to follow, because we have lost the sense that there's hope that we can do anything about it. And that's the second way in which this is a country to envy. Because what drew me to this country originally, the reason I wanted to come and to learn more about this country, was the extraordinary process, the democratic process, the crowdsourced process to produce a response to the 2008 crisis in the form of the Constitution, the draft Constitution that came out of the Constitutional Council. Because when that story is told, especially to Americans, the story of 1,000 people gathered together randomly to identify the values, and then an election to elect people to what became a council, including people like Kata here, who then worked for 4 months to draft a constitution, which is the same time it took our founders to draft a constitution, but the framers of the American Constitution didn't post their drafts to Facebook the way they did, and that posting process produced feedback, which produced ultimately what I think is a beautiful, powerful constitution, which was then supported by more than two-thirds of the public. When you tell that story in America, people hear the music rising in the background, the excitement of the idea that, my God, democracy is possible again. And then you say, oh, but did you hear? For 4 years, the parliament has done nothing. So what I hope is that this beautiful place can show the world that democracy is possible, that this process of reclaiming and capturing the idea of a government responsive to the people, solving it, is possible again. And I've been so inspired by the leadership that we've seen from your party in putting this issue central so that the people have a chance to say, this is the democracy we want to have. There's so much to envy. And I hope that there's so much more to envy when your work is finished.
Thank you. Okay, so now, we can start talking together. So, what I have here is a movable mic, and I want to see hands in the air if anybody wants to raise a question or comment. I would really be happy if it could be short, and if you could direct it at a certain person. So I think I'm going to have some assistance. Yes, great. Okay, so there's a one hand up there. We'll start there. I would really be also very happy if it was both men and women who would speak. Of all age groups, yes.
Yeah, I want to ask, thank Eva Joly first for coming here. It's great, it's awesome. I remember when you had to leave the country, it was really sad. And I hope that more would have been done, but we're in this position today, and we have a chance. That's important. I want to ask Johannes Kauer about the fishing industry. I know that there is some information that we've been waiting for, and I want to know if he can tell me anything about it, like any dates or anything.
Hello? Coming soon.
To your ears, Saba. Okay. If anybody also from the panel wants to jump in at any stage, they are as equal as the audience to jump in.
Hi, my name is Sunna. I want to thank you all for being here and having such interesting talks. I wanted to ask, perhaps in particular, Eva Joly, thank you so much for being here. If you consider you know, because we heard before further points of political responsibility, more than just resigning. I mean, I would also like to hear from the rest of the panel, but I do believe, and I'm pretty certain, that we have laws that deal with public officials that abuse their position. And I feel like this has been very lacking in the discussion about the Panama Papers, that there are, you know, there are reasons to believe that people abuse their power and misuse public power for their own gain. And what would be our best tools of dealing with this and actually taking real responsibility, as in, you know, prosecution or a proper investigation at least?
That is exactly what the Panama Papers Committee is about. It is to try to answer the question, how was it possible that all the member states and the associated countries did allow all this money to leave the countries when we have the anti-money laundering laws in place? How is it that it was not applied? And we know how much money is in the offshore account, that we know from the International Bank of Settlement. We are talking about, well, it's not very precise, $11 trillion, $14 trillion, when the whole world's production is $65 trillion. Huge amount of money that is escaping all kind of rules. And this is not possible if the laws in place were applied. So they are not applied. And why are they not applied? Many reasons for that. One is lack of staff to do the job, incompetence, but also probably corruption in many countries. Because money laundering is a business. You are earning money by laundering it. And that we have seen from banks like HSBC that knowingly did launder drug trafficking money from Mexico, for instance. We know that. So it is a business. It was a business for Cyprus to launder Russian oligarchs' money. The world knows about it, but it's like we are unable to stop it because so much money is on stake and people can pay for it. But the good news is that the public opinion don't accept it anymore. The world is changing very quickly. And now we see in France, for instance, people that cheated on their taxes, like very famous people, they got now 3 years of imprisonment. And the lawyers who helped them have got 6 months of imprisonment. But the most important thing is that you have solidarity among culprits, meaning that the lawyers will have to pay back the tax they helped evade. People have not understood this yet. They are still at the old model. But when this will get known, that you are at risk, not only in your freedom, but also in your money, this will change. And in the committee that I'm working with and on, we will come up with proposals. And one of these proposals, it is known since long, as the money that are taken care of from these offshore companies, they do not stay in Panama or in Cayman Island. There is nothing there. This money is invested in Reykjavik, in flats, it's invested in Dubai, in New York, and in London. So what we could agree upon is we should have an asset register, and it should not be admitted that anything belongs to anonymous persons. Today in London, whole parts of the town are empty because people do not trust immaterial goods anymore, and they buy flats, but they are not living in these flats, and nobody knows who owns them. We don't need a world like this. This will change because also in England, people do not accept that the washing lady pays more taxes than the rich man next door. So I believe very strongly that the work that we are doing in the parliament will help this. And I'm also confident that if you give a beautiful majority to the Pirate Party, your parliament would set up an inquiry committee.
Hello. Hi, my name is Andreas. I'm from the Left Greens, so this is my first pirate meeting. It's nice being with you. Being here reminds me of how important individuals have been in getting us through the years after the crash. Even if we always have a huge amount of people doing the work, having Eva Joly come just after the crash to deal with the banksters was invaluable. And the Panama Papers, even if we had hundreds of journalists all over the world working on them, having Johannes at the helm in Iceland, without him, we wouldn't have gotten the results we did. So we can all thank them. And another important thing is the role of independent media, and especially in the case of the Panama Papers, small independent media, and the state broadcaster. So I think I would like to ask Þórður, I'm sure he could fill a few meetings on this subject. What do you see as the most important thing to do to for us from the political side to assist media in being independent, being strong enough to deal with these cases?
Well, first of all, help us to survive. Every privately owned media in Iceland is losing money. Most of them are owned or funded by people that are part of the problem, not part of the solution. And this is a scenario that's been going on way too long. I think it's up to the politicians to find the solutions on how you want to fix this problem. But we have, through the course of last few years, frequently pointed out what the problem is. The problem is that we need to fund ourselves either by raiding the pockets of people that own vast amounts of money. And most of those people have something to hide. A lot of them have something to hide. And do not want to fund critical media. Or we have to rely upon the advertisement market, which is obviously the companies in this country. And as you know, the politicians here and most of the people that live here is becoming more concentrated by the day, the ownership of these countries, of these companies, because there's a small portion of Icelanders, a handful of Icelanders that are getting very rich, very fast, especially in the post-crash era, from sort of the redistribution of wealth and assets that have that has occurred through the old banks and the new banks, and because the devaluation of the Icelandic krona has made their export companies mostly. Export companies that rely on the usage of natural assets like fisheries, that made those exports larger when they're counted in kronas. So this is the problem. It's here for everybody to see. It's up to the politicians to find the solution. We have pointed out the problem. We have sort of pointed to the directions of what the solution can be. I mean, it can be grants of some sort, it can be tax breaks of some sort, but if we want our democracy to stand firm in these times, which are probably the most interesting times we've ever lived, huge social changes going on, political and social changes, we need a strong media. We've shown in the last few years that the media in Iceland can be very strong, but I'm I'm full of fear that it's bleeding out, especially now, because I see more and more people with the know-how and the experience leaving this field because it's long hours, it's shit pay, and it's very difficult to do in such a small society as the Icelandic one.
Can you, yeah. Hi, my name is Haugon. I want to ask Leszek that if you would agree that the internet was the revolution that precedes all change in government, and if our current form of representative governance is outdated as a result of the information at our fingertips, especially in regards to government accountability.
So that's a great question. The internet is a sort of revolution, but it's a revolution both for the good and a revolution for the bad. So it's for the good because it does facilitate much greater accountability, and we've seen it used to hold governments accountable where the media in the middle would not have otherwise held those governments accountable. But for the bad, you need to look at the way the media in America has developed. You know, we've seen a radical deconcentration of news sources. And what that's done in a world where they are dependent, this is exactly following the last answer, where they are dependent on commercial interests to fund their work, is that they've become hostage to what's the most crazy idea out there. So Donald Trump is a product of journalists who are unable to edit journalism. They had no freedom not to cover Donald Trump 24/7 for all of this year because he was such a phenomenon that there was competition that drove everybody to follow. And I think what it forces us to do is exactly what was suggested. We have to think of the mechanisms that give us back responsible, careful editorial judgment about media and governance in a context where what we've inherited, as the internet has affected it, weakens that ability dramatically. So I think that is, for me, the problem. I don't even, in American context, have the beginning of a sense of how to solve. Lots of creative ideas of ways to fund different kinds of journalism, but I agree, this has become a central problem if, you know, in contexts like the United States, we're facing the choice that we're facing right now for something like the President of the United States.
Thank you. Birgitta wants to jump in, please?
Yes. So we are in this transitional times with everything, including the media. And I think it is so important. I don't think it. It is like the critical aspect of society so that people can actually make informed decisions, that we have strong independent media and that we have the means for journalists to be able to do investigative journalism. And that is, you know, very difficult in a small society like Iceland, and it needs to be supported. There have been some discussions about grants for investigations, for example, because most of the media in Iceland has huge difficulties to do this. But on the other hand, when we talk about the internet and its capacity, just to see this army of investigative journalists work on the Panama Papers and the results of that would never have been possible without the internet. And that is also important to bear in mind that because things are leaking all over, the possibility for people to hide is a lot less. And so we will be seeing huge consequences, but we have to have media to report it. So I agree about the worries, and it was an excellent question, Andres, about our media and the concentration of the media to certain political powers or oligarchs. So that is something I hope all parties can agree on, that we need to amend very quickly after the elections. And it is not a party. I hope that there are people from all parties here, because I think the messages that are coming out of this conference about corruption are far greater than one party.
Thank you. Thanks, Brigitte. I also wanted to give Sigurbjörg a chance to comment.
A little bit to this question, what could politicians do to help media? One thing that I think politicians, and in particular here in Iceland, because it's new in Iceland, they have to be concerned about and become aware of, that it is the new reality of life in politics. And the new reality is that because of the impact, the effect of the leaking of information into media in just the last electoral term, causing two resignations of ministers. Just because of this impact, the demand for leaked information and the services of hackers will be rising. That is the new reality of in political life. And there are measures to avoid such a disruption for a system. I'm saying for a system because I'm political analyst of public administrative systems, and I understand that this can cause a huge disruption, sometimes damaging consequences for the system. Government needs to make sure that the Public Information Act is more easily applied by journalists. They need to have systems within that forms a proper framework about whistleblowers. The more kind of dodgy a system starts to look like, the higher pressure there will be for getting out information and getting out no matter what. Mm-hmm. And the services of perfect, brilliant hackers is out there.
Yeah, my name is Kristin Vala, and I was very interested to hear Madame Jolie mention that offshore accounts are not only set up to hide money from taxes, but are also available for hiding kickbacks. And that brought me to think about, is there any evidence that you, investigative journalists, and you, Madame Jolie, are working on, that points to that there are public officials in Iceland who have received kickbacks from various sources, oligarchs, big corporations who work in Iceland, etc.
You can only induce from this system and the way it is used all over the world that is what it's set up for. This means, in terms of your penal code, that you have legitimate reason for suspicions, and that is enough to start an investigation. So people having these special companies, in my opinion, should be investigated. That is not dangerous. If really there was nothing to hide when we closed the file. But you cannot find it out without these, the investigation and international cooperation, because you need the company, and then you need to know the bank accounts of the company and to see where the money comes from that is going into this account. And money is leaving traces, so we can find it out, but you need an investigation. And the good news is now that Iceland has one of the best economic crime units in the world.
Would you, journalists, might want to add some comments to this, or?
Kickbacks is it's a difficult term. Because you have this image of kickbacks being some shady figure bringing money in a brown paper bag to some corrupt politician, and it has he's paying for some sort of direct action. That sort of kickbacks we don't see in Iceland, but we see maybe more soft corruption, and more we see it more in cycles. We see people both in business and politics that rely on other people for access to power, access to opportunities and access to funds, and they in return do their deed in their field of work. It's not as A to B as just delivering a bag full of money, and it's much more difficult to prove and report on. And I agree with Mrs. Jolie that this is something that we need to investigate. And just related to another question that was here earlier, what we need to do with the information that came out of the Panama Papers is to investigate them. We have, the media has done its part. Johannes broke the story. A lot of the other media in Iceland followed it up. We see the results. Our prime minister resigned due to corruption for the first time in Icelandic history. And since then, we've heard nothing about this. We have reported on almost most of the most interesting angles of the leak that are related to Iceland, and we haven't seen anything in return. We don't know how many people have been, how many people are going to be prosecuted because of tax-related matters. There's no transparency about those investigations. There's nothing, maybe, going on in the parliament. There was no research committee put up to investigate these leaks or anything like that, which are all possibilities that we could have done. We've done that before. We put up investigative committees a few times to go through the bank crash. So I would have liked to see either the parliament develop some tools to tackle these problems, or if they have those tools, use them.
There are two questions waiting, but I just first would like to give
I just want to follow up a little bit on what you said, Thordur, about we may not have much of a problem about this big brown bags with money in Iceland, and you might be right in that. The brown envelopes might not be the problem of the type of corruption we have in Iceland, but the type of corruption we have in Iceland is something scientists who are looking into democratic corruption in democratic societies have labeled violation of public trust. And violation of public trust takes place when you, in a democratic society, you have delegated power to a person to act on your behalf, and when that person fails, that is violation of public trust. And therefore, violation of public trust as a corruption, as a new type of corruption, might be more widespread, something that you called for softer type of corruption, but might lead to a hugely damaging effect for sort of as a downstream effect in society.
This sort of corruption that we live with here in Iceland, I've boiled it down to access to opportunities. I think that's the best way to put it. People either pay or use their kinship to get better access to opportunities. And these opportunities can be used to gain wealth, they can be used to gain power. But there is a portion of Icelanders that have better access to all opportunities, and they use it sort of to tighten their stronghold on society.
Because we have developed a sort of a stream of thought, I would like Jón to have a comment that he wants to say, and then I'm not forgetting about those two people who want to have questions.
I just want to second what Silla is saying, because I think it is hugely important to understand that corruption is not brown bags with money. It's also that. But corruption, one definition that I think covers a lot of ground is corruption is activity that undermines trust in public institutions and rules and regulations of society. And I think you said it, I just want to second it because I think it's so important to realize that corruption does not always involve money. And I fear from, I don't have proof, but the anecdotal evidence that we have from parts of Iceland that often public officials, they, a bottle of whiskey will do the job.
Hard liquor corruption.
Anybody that read the book Drömmalandið or seen the film, they know exactly what is being discussed here.
Mm-hmm. We have a question.
Yes, my name is Solveig Dagmar Þórisdóttir. I was in the Independent Party. I'm a pirate today. I'm very proud of that. I work with tourism and I have people asking me all day along when I work out the site on the field, showing our lovely country to our lovely tourists that come here and provide us a lot of salary also from all over the world. They ask me about the pirates, they ask me about the liberty, they ask me about the republic. And I need to ask myself also when I'm at a meeting here that I see like a positive wave going forward into a new period, right? So we have a lovely candidate here going in probably, and I worry a little bit about the old parties there, which are there also at the line. So I think it's very important to have Eva Joly to come here to remind us that we have the spirit to fight. I was in California, just came from there. I was asked many times about Iceland. I was also asked about what you think about Trump, you know. So I have this question all the day along in my tours. And even yesterday, I had a doctor from America, a cancer doctor, doing surgery, about asking me about what are you doing with the bankers. So I need to ask myself, why am I here? I believe in the spirit of liberty, and I believe in the republic that we did establish here just before, of course, before 1262, after the oldest parliament in Þingvellir, which we still have here in Iceland, in Reykjavík, and 63 members do go there soon, new members, also from the Pirate Party. So I hope the best for you, Birgitta, and all of you, the scientists here, doing some research, that you will find the spirit, keep the spirit up. I hope that Trump that will not be elected. I hope that the Republic of America will keep on also, like we are doing here. So I'm very happy to be here among you. Thank you.
Very positive. Here we go.
Yeah, I have some information and also a question. The government owns 53 companies that go over the 51% limit. There are rules that say that information, it's the Information Act that says that they have to give us information of who buys these companies and for what they are sold. We're not getting this information because they get like an exception from this act, which is, in my opinion, something that we really need to look into. I would like to ask, is there any example of it in the world that companies have actually been given to people instead of money, like, you know, as a form of payment for doing something?
It's for Eva too.
Yes. There are really lots of ways to pay. And in my investigations, I think the most difficult kind of corruption was when ELF bought bankrupt banks, for instance, or took up companies in very bad shape in order to help the owners, you know. And then it's very difficult to prove the limit between bad business and corruption. So it is not always money. It can be all kind of payments. It can be advantages given to a member of the family, or it can be it's not necessary money, for sure. And there are so many ways, and especially with multinational companies that has, you know, 900 subsidiaries, they can pay from one of these subsidiaries, and it can really be very, very good hidden. So this is why we must turn it around and never forget that when you have suspicions of serious suspicion of corruption, you can start the investigation and you do a house search to start with, because then you will find traces maybe of assets that are not declared.
Then actually I heard that the Green Group in the EU Parliament has now like a button where you can, or a system where you can leak documents. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes. I go to the mic. Yes. We have a lot of corruption also in the EU that is very seldom investigated, because the organ that we have to do it is called OLAF, and it is very weak and under rather political influence. And this corruption is possible because of secrecy. The Parliament don't have access to all the documents that we should have access to. Lot of bad habits. So we, the Greens, we thought that, and this was an experience from the former committee we had set up, we, the Greens, that was called TAX, after LuxLeaks. We made inquiries, and we wanted documents from the Commission about the member states' attitude in the special committee called Code of Conduct that was set up in the 80s to discuss harmful tax practices. And we were denied these documents in the first time, and then we got very difficult ways, little access. And then some courageous members of the Commission did leak the documents. They did come and give it to us, or they sent it by mail, which is dangerous. And so this was the way we got the idea to set up EU Leaks, which is a secured platform where anybody can send anonymously information they have got of public interest, information that should go out to the public. Because, you know, EU has huge power as to your health, admitting which medicine can be admitted to the market, what kind of pesticide can be used in agriculture. And all these decisions are hugely important. And the Parliament don't have access to the files, because when the authorization is given, it is on the files of the multinational companies' research, and this is covered by secrecy. So it is forbidden for us to get into it. But we have so much conflict of interest, and we have seen that, for instance, in the Mediator case that you might recall, between 1,000 and 2,000 people died only in France of thickening of the valves in the heart. And this effect of the medicine was known for more than 10 years when at last this medicine was forbidden. And then we found that the people that should have acted were also on the board of Servier. They were sitting on both sides. And these are things that I still have difficulties to believe. How can you choose the benefit of the company against 1,000 people dying? And this is also true for the pesticides, for the asbestos. In France, we have now 100,000 victims of asbestos, because we didn't forbid the use of asbestos while Norway did it in the 70s. In France, it was done in 92. Meaning that we sacrificed for the benefit of the Eternit companies 100,000 people. So you cannot trust these situations anymore. The benefit has taken is the only value. And then you see this secured platform is for the people in the Commission or elsewhere that has these documents telling us that in this experiment of this medicine, 10 people died before they got to the end. This is information of public interest. And I also believe that many people know
about the secret bank accounts, about the secret meetings, that one commissioner, for instance, in the Bahama Leaks, that is not very old, I mean, that is maybe 1 month old, we learned that Nelly Cruz, she used to be commissioner for competition for energy. She's from the Netherlands. She had set up a secret company in Bahamas along with a Saudi, wealthy Saudi, and she obliged you to privatize your energy that you enjoyed free of charge here, for some of you. She obliged you to privatize, and you know what? Her private company was there to buy. And this, a lot of people knew about it, but the information did not get out. So the EU leak platform that is now only 1 month old is there for this purpose, to get the information out without exposing the author for the sanctions, because when you are a whistleblower, you are losing your job and you get ahead of huge difficulties. And this is true also in Iceland. I mean, it's true everywhere. So to be able to give out the information without telling who you are is very important. So I'm proud of this initiative. I'm proud of our group that did finance this project. That was an idea that popped up working here in Iceland and also with Julian Assange. I saw how he did it. And I think that this can be very useful, really, to throw more light on the work of the EU and to make it more oriented by the public and the public good.
Hi everybody, my name is Sturla, and I'm going to try to use my English as well as I can. You were talking about the corruptions, and we have a share office in Sýslumaður in Iceland. I think we call it a sheriff in Iceland. It seems like the media and the politician sitting in the Congress, they don't want to talk about this thing. Since 2008, have been about 8,000 to 9,000 closure on homes and companies. And they don't talk about the amount of money that's lying there. It's about 400,000 to 600,000 million Icelandic krona. And this cannot happen except with the help from the sheriff's office. And so one thing is I'm wondering about is why the media don't talk about it, and also the people on the Congress, because today, a lot of my friends is looking on the face of these people and they're taking the home of them still today because they have not finished to, close up the crash on Iceland. It's still going on, and it's a lot of homes they are going to take in the future. And the thing I want to ask is, can it be the corruption in the share offices because they don't look into the law or anything when they are taking the home of people? They just take it and hope that people don't have money or anything to defend themselves against these bankers. And also, sometime in the court in Iceland, they are helping also the banks, how they judge. And I have lived it all. So I think the corruption is in the sheriff's office, Congress, and the judge system, and also the lawyer system, because I have met a lot of them. And they are actually working for the bank when you are paying them and believing they are working for you. They are actually working for the bank. So that's one thing to investigate. It's a lot of billions they are taking from the families in Iceland.
Anyone like to respond?
So the committee on oversight, just before the parliament finished, did have quite a few meetings with an organization on debtors or who had had bad experience, for example, with the office of umboðsmaður skuldara. So, and I thought that it was
debtors ombudsman.
Yes, yes, and I thought it was incredible how so many of these foreclosures were dealt with. I noticed that there was a group of people that actually went to many of the auctions to bid in, so that the final bid that the sheriff would do would go a little bit higher. There has been very little, so that people would actually not have to have so much burden. There were some people that did that, heimavarnarlið, right? And but it's on a systematic level. There has been very little done to make sure that people will not fall into the same traps if there would be another crash. And that is not only in Iceland, but everywhere. So very little has happened when it comes to making sure that the banks don't get exactly like they became before the crash. There's been very little effort in that regard. And I think, you know, all these different offices that you talked about, Stulli, all of this need to be looked into, obviously. And the committee, there will be the work of the oversight committee will carry on to work with the umboðsmaður skuldara and not umboðsmaður félag skuldara. And because I think I keep hearing horror stories all the time that are very disturbing, and there will be another crash one day, and then people don't have any protections even then, after everything.
This is the general problem with systemic corruption. And one way to see it is how infrequently systemic corruption can be the topic of a successful journalistic expose. I mean, the Panama Papers really is possible to have the effect it had because of that completely clumsy interview by the Prime Minister, which turned it into an international story. And but for that, the potential of that story to have the effect that it actually had was tiny. Right? And this is just because of the way narrative works, right? We are interested in the good guy, the bad guy, the one person who's made a really mistake or clumsy, and that's what we focus on. And if that person isn't in the story, they can get away with corruption for a very long time. So you tell the story of asbestos. I mean, there's a fantastic book called Doubt Is Their Product, which in the United States tells a story of lead, asbestos, cigarettes, chromium 6, all of these products which these companies knew were killing people. But they calculated they could muddy the waters for 10 or 12 or 15 years, and nobody would be able to figure out enough to stop them. And by the end, they would be outed, and this would be a dangerous product. But in the middle time, they would have made millions of dollars selling those products. And systematically, there is no journalist who could come forward with, you know, the evidence that shows that asbestos is bad because it's scientific evidence, and who's going to be. This is why we need effective democracy, government we can trust, who we know is interested in what the people care about and not what the special interests of the biggest, richest people in a particular country care about. And this is the great gap in democracies around the world. We have to recognize how tenuous democracy is. Most people have no faith in democracy. In the United States, we have no faith in democracy. That's why you know, there are a bunch of crazy racists in the United States supporting Donald Trump, no doubt. But there's a whole bunch of people supporting Donald Trump because they just want to give the finger to the system. They just think that this system is so corrupted, they'll blow it up, and they don't care because they are so angry with the way the system has worked. And until we can restore a sense that democracy works, We have no hope to deal with these systemic problems. And that's why finding examples of the people rising up and doing something against all odds becomes so important, because that's the journalistic story that can begin to inspire people around the world. It happened here. You're able to do it here. And then if you do it here, we'll do it in Greece. And if we do it in Greece, we can do it in the United States. You know, there are so many places we can grow it from, but it has to happen here now.
Thank you very much for this meeting. It's very interesting, and I'm glad finally to have met Madame Eva Schulli. I would like to follow up Sturla Jonsson's comments and his worries about the integrity of the justice system. And I'm a former judge at the district court in Reykjavik. I was a judge for 6 years. I'm a former deputy judge and also the former director of the court's councils. And why did I leave my position, my this high position, highly ranked in society with a secure monthly paid, and become a non-profit lobbyist 1 year ago? Yes, why did I do that? That's because I did not, because of my principles, I did not see my own interest rather than the interest of the society to serve a court system which has seriously deficiencies, which I already had then informed the Ministry of Justice without no reactions. And the last year I have been, have tried to reach some reactions from parliamentarians, institution, and also the media. And I have not leaked information privately. I have publicly given this society critique and given the parliament last in May a review about the new legislation on the courts, which I believe did not take notice of any of the problems, as the Ombudsman Althingi has actually stated newly with a meeting with the Constitutional Committee last September the 6th. We have discussed here, and among others things, the role of the media. And what I have been really questioning is the role of the media, because it doesn't, there's one media here, it's Stundin, who has written a big review of the court system, for example, in a 4 pages article in last July. But no other medias, not the state media or Thordir's media, they have not shown any interest. And I would like to address you in the panel, for you, Thordir, and Birgitta. What is, for what reasons? Why are we are like a small village, and we are a village where you see, you don't actually seem to see it as some problem when a judge leaves its position and gives the show at the critic, and no one can investigate. Thank you very much.
Directed the question to the two of you, so Thordur, if you would like to
start. Well, from my perspective and my media perspective, me and Oslo, we have spoken many times about the situation. I completely agree with her, the pitfalls that she's pointed out in her non-profit lobbyist work. The reason why we can't do a full-depth research on the Icelandic judicial system is just because we don't have the manpower. We're a six-man company. And we have to prioritize. Our level of expertise is economics, business, and politics. That's where we're best. The people that we have available are best. I would really
would have liked to dive into a case like the one that Ausle has been talking about. But we simply don't have the manpower, we don't have the time, and we have to prioritize. And there's been so many other things going on that we have felt that we had been better situated to report on during these last few years than diving into the pitfalls of the judicial system. But as you pointed out, Stunden did it this summer. They had a very fine, long read article about it. And hopefully other media will have the opportunity to follow up on it with sort of the intensity that it is required. But I fully admit that the judicial system is not my level of expertise, and I'm not the best fitted to investigate it. From my personal perspective and my media company, the media company I run.
Okay. If I can just answer very quickly, because it was directed to me as well. So I did actually read your letters, and I did speak to the chairman of the committee, of the Oversight and Constitutional Committee, and we did meet with you because we were concerned about the issues you raised. This was during the last days of the parliament, so of course it did not go any further until hopefully next. Because it is a very serious issue that needs to be addressed in some way so that we can resurrect trust in this particular institution that is has to do with justice. And then I think it is, we actually did make a special a boken into the report about, we made a special a special notice so that the work around this will carry on to the next session in the parliament. So it is not forgotten and it will not be forgotten, and we will rely on your insight into this to help find ways to fix this huge problem that we have in this regard.
Great. Now we have officially run out of time, but because we have the rare opportunity of having Eva with us, and I, what do I have to do to get this Madame part to my name? I want to be Madame Kadrin. But we have only one Madame at this room at the moment, and I would like to ask her to maybe finish off this wonderful meeting, and thank you all. So sorry about not being able to give the word back to you, but I just want to end on time. It's a principle of mine. So please, Eva, if you could just say a few final words, and then I want to thank you all.
First, I want to say two words to our judge that resigned from her position. She paid a high price to let us know what the state of the justice is. This is very important information, and I'm sure that it will be taken care of. And if you should need help to understand, I think we could do something about it together. And I feel that there is a lot of energy and hope in this room. And I think that time has come really to bring forward changement, to give up the old boys, because we know that it's the same people that did run the central bank, the government, the newspapers. They are the same, and they have lived their life. Times they are a changing. This is a new time, and now this is a. We take the signal. This is now a Nobel Prize winner, and. So I think that times they are a-changing, and the pirates, they will carry out this changement, I hope, in close cooperation with the Greens, so that also the environmental subject can be part of the program very strongly, because we have to work for future generations, for better democracy, but we cannot give up all the environmental subjects. So I'm very confident today that we will find solutions to this corruption by having new ideas and a political will, which is the most important, and a lot of help also from academia to find the good solutions, and courageous people in Iceland. That is the most valuable asset. So thank you, and I was really happy to be able to come here to support the Pirates. They are with us in the Green Group in the European Parliament, and I must say that this little group, we are only 54 people out of more than 700, but without us, the Parliament would be much more boring. So I think this is c'est de bon augure, and I wish you, Birgitta, I cross my fingers for these elections, and I had a lot of hope for the Icelandic society, who do merit better government. When I came up here first, I was so impressed that this country with 330,000 inhabitants, they have wonderful artists, they have a wonderful literature, they have a philharmonic orchestra, and they have services of nephrology. So really, this is unbelievable.
So that will be our conclusion for today. Thank you all very much for a lovely meeting. Good luck.